Patel is a man of many shades. He's a painter, a playwright, and a poet, with the human condition and the human body a constant in his work. He's here with the Chandigarh Lalit Kala Academy for a slide show and presentation titled The Brush and the Eye. We speak to Gieve about his journey and his art. Welcome to the Chandigarh Lalit Kala Academy.
Thank you, Parul.
So how's it been so far? You're a physician, you're a poet and a playwright and a painter. So how do all these varied streams come together with you as a person?
That they don't come together.
They don't come together. Interesting.
Right. You know, in the sense that I see each one of them as a very specific activity which needs its own special kind of attention. If they came together, it would be a mess. and then why would one practice so many things if one could say something equally well in one or the other?
Right.
So I'm very aware of the fact that there's some things in my experience which can only be conveyed through painting. It cannot, you know, be conveyed through a poem, and so on, you know.
True.
And that is why, you know, I practice these various things. And that is why, in a certain kind of way, I like to keep them apart.
Okay. So medicine, was it something that medicine came from your parents, or was it your first choice?
I come from a medical family.
Okay.
My grandfather was a village doctor.
Okay.
And his son was a village doctor for a while before he moved to Bombay.
Okay.
And, you know, I remember at the age of 7 or 8, accompanying my grandfather in the middle of the night in a horse tonga.
Oh, wow.
To visit patients.
This was in Mumbai, Gieve?
This was in Gujarat.
It in
was
Gujarat.
In a little seaside village called Nargol. And, you know, and I have fairly romantic memories of those days. And I think that that definitely impelled me to choose medicine as something I wanted to practice.
Okay. And you practiced it up till almost 10 years back?
Yeah, I retired from medical practice about 10 years ago.
Okay. And how
did I put in like 35 years of work and with medicine.
Okay. As a private practitioner?
Well, I worked first as a government practitioner at the primary health center in Gujarat for about a year and a half. And then I moved to Bombay as a private practitioner.
And when did painting or poetry happen along the journey?
I've been writing poetry from school days.
Okay.
And of course, you know, most of the early poetry, you know, is juvenile rubbish and, you know, written mainly for the school magazine and in order to impress other school children. I think that poetry which I have preserved, I would say, comes from like around the age of 19, 20 onwards. Because painting, I started late. I started painting around the age of 17 or so.
With no formal training?
No formal training. Somebody gave me a gift of some books of classical Western painting, and I looked at them and I started copying those works in pencil and watercolor. And then, you know, then after that, I just took off on my own.
Okay, so all self-taught, the painting?
Yeah, it was self-taught. But, you know, I did put myself through fairly rigorous self-training, you know, in the sense that I would say that between the age of 17 and, say, 22, which means 5 years, was really, you know, a matter of telling myself how to work, you know. I sought help.
Okay.
I asked some senior painters for help. I got very amusing responses. There were some who shrugged me off, you know, saying, what is a medical student, you know, doing?
Not.
Yeah. Wasting his time with painting. But Akbar Padamsi was extremely receptive.
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, Akbar used to work in Paris at that time. He used to paint there. But he would visit here once a year. And when I showed him my work, he was very generous At the same time, he was also fairly critical,
okay,
very usefully critical, you know. He would tell me exactly where I was going wrong and how I should look at things. So it soon became a kind of a, you know, routine between us that I would be painting through the whole year and I'd wait for that one visit that he'd make once a year to, okay, Bombay, and then collectively show him all the work I'd done in the year.
Right. And what were you painting those days, Sergey, when you showed these
works? I was
works?
Trying to paint like Akbar Padamsi.
Okay, okay. So the subjects were quite... And what did he have to say?
Oh, he pretended not to notice.
So it was useful, the interaction?
Oh, it was very, very useful.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know what I would have done without Akbar's support.
Okay.
And of course, later on, you know, he continued for many years to be a mentor. And, you know, now, of course, we're also very good friends.
And in those days, what were your impressions? What were your inspirations in painting? Was it Western classical painting? Or were you also looking at a lot of Indian art?
Yes. I remember attending three or four lectures which Ibrahim Alkazi gave in Bombay,
okay,
on 14th century Italian painting. And you know, these lectures, I thought, were absolutely seminal. And I'm sure that there are many people who remember those lectures. There were lectures on Giotto, on Masaccio,
okay,
and Piero della Francesca. And to this day, you know, they are among the most important painters for me.
Okay.
You know? And that's largely due to the insight into them that I derived from Alkazi's talks.
And it reflected in your work as well as practice?
Oh, I mean, I think it's presumptuous to say that, you know, okay, one's work could reflect anything of that mastery.
Hmm.
But it was certainly important to me.
And did it, your medicine study, did it interfere with your practice of art or your... because it is a different field and a lot
I don't think that I felt that the medical practice was in any way obstructing any of the other activities.
Okay. But the human body, the element of the human body and its many facets,
I know,
appear in your poetry as well as...
Yes. I'm often asked this question, and I'm not sure I have the right answer. But my answer is that it is quite possible that had I not studied medicine, had I not become a doctor, my paintings and my poetry would even so have referred to the human body. Maybe in a slightly different way.
Okay.
I mean, I can't discount the influence of the medical practice completely. It's got to be there because it's such an important part of my life. So it has to come into the works. But as subject matter, I think that I might have, you know, reflected on the human body even so. Because, you know, the human body doesn't belong only to medical practitioners. It belongs to all of us.
That's right.
And all of us carry it with us for 70 years, 80 years. And so we better think about it.
Mm. And in what way does it reflect in your works as physical or metaphysical? Because you did mention the internal eye when you mentioned your painting. So how does the human body reflect itself?
I think that, for instance, the first book of poems,
yes,
which came out in 1966 and which is titled Poems, has many poems which are directly about the experiences of a young doctor, you know, encountering a patient, encountering a childbirth, encountering the death of a patient, you know. And these paintings, these poems in that sense are perhaps talking about the day-to-day physical realities,
okay,
of dealing with human bodies. By the time you come to the second book of poems, which the first book was published in 1966, the second book of poems, which was titled How Do You Withstand Body, was published in 1976, which is 10 years later. I think by that time, again, of course, there's a lot of reference to the human body. But I think by that time, the human body has become more generalized.
Okay.
No, it is not this particular patient or that particular death. It's a much broader meditation on the destiny of the human body.
Okay. Right. And along the poetry, did it appear on canvas as well? The same subject? Because human conditions appear a lot on your canvas. The
yes.
ordinary man appears a lot on your
yeah.
canvas.
There's often a time ellipse.
Hmm.
Like, I was talking about the human body in the poems through the 60s and the 70s.
Right.
In the painting, the human body in terms of death and disease comes up in the 1980s.
Okay, so 20 years.
So, you know, yeah.
yeah.
So
okay, okay.
And I'm no explanation for it.
Right. And your paintings also reflect the conditions of the times that you live in, the urban landscape, and also the people.
Yes.
So tell us a little about your works and the series of paintings which
yes.
inspired these subjects.
Right.
And what constantly drives you to explore these subjects in different ways?
You know, I think an artist works from one work to the next. It's true that, you know, you sometimes give it a long-term reflection. And you do think, like, you know, what are my preoccupations? You know, what will I be doing 5 years from now? But most often, it's really, you know, you finish one work, and then, you know, something nudges you, and you start another work.
Right.
And you're totally immersed. Your attention is immersed in that particular work at that time. You're not thinking of what you did in the past and what you'll be doing in the future. However, when you have to talk about your work, like today, you know, or when I'm giving a presentation, it would be quite dull, you know, to keep talking about one work after the
True.
Other, you know.
True.
You tend to then take a longer view.
Okay.
And for such occasions, you know, you think, like, what are the kinds of works I do and why?
Mm.
And so I found that I do three kinds of works.
Okay.
Again, as I said to you, you know, all this thinking is post-work, you know, post having worked. It's not while you're working, you're not thinking of these classifications. But after having worked, you know, you do reflect, why is it that I work in these three different areas?
Okay.
So these three different areas are the human being in a setting. Which could be an urban setting or a rural setting. Then the second area that I seem to work on is death and decay.
Right.
And the third area that I have been working on since 1991 now, and will continue to work on, I think, indefinitely, is a subject which is, I broadly titled, Looking into a Well.
Okay.
You know, which is a boyhood experience, which I rediscovered at the age of 50.
Okay.
And decided to, you know, work on paintings portraying this experience. And by now, you know, there must be like 25 versions of this, each of them, you know, distinctive and different, each of them a separate experience. So it's not really a formal exercise, you know, from one painting to the next.
Right.
And I'd say that broadly speaking, these are celebratory paintings, you know.
I get your point. And this probably comes from your experience with your grandfather in the Tongas and all the villages.
Right. That's right.
So yeah. how do you paint? Is this water in the well?
You know, the first thing is that when you, the experience of looking into a well is, if you look at the physical dynamics of it, is that you are standing in front of a well and you're looking down.
True.
And you see the surface of the water, you see the sides of the well, you see the vegetation, you see the reflection on the surface, you see the transparency of the water right down into the bottom as one visual impression, you know, or multiple impressions. But still you're looking down. When you're painting, you're not looking down. You're not painting like that, you know. Mm. Your painting is in front of you on the wall. So the first technical problem is how do you translate an experience where you're looking down to one where you're looking straight ahead.
Okay.
And convey that feeling.
Absolutely.
You know. And that is a part of the excitement of the project for me. You
know. Okay.
The second part of, again, most often when people talk of looking down into a cylindrical space, they see it as vertiginous, something that sucks you down. Whereas for me, the experience is joyful.
Okay.
So it is not fearful, it is not vertiginous. With the result that none of my wells give a feeling that you're going to be sucked down into that space.
Okay.
In fact, people have said that they're not very sure whether they are looking down into a well or whether they aren't actually down in the well, stationed down in the well and are looking up at the sky.
Oh, how interesting.
And I'm very comfortable with this ambiguity.
Okay. And so this, a lot of work I was reading of yours stems from memory. And you do, you're in no hurry to get it on canvas, but it has to be on in your heart and mind for a very long time. So any more series like these? Which,
well, you know, many of the paintings that have the human figure, that particular human figure, that situation of those two or three human figures has been with me for many years before I even attempt to put it down on a canvas.
Mm.
I'll give you an example. Like one of a very common sight in Bombay, which most anybody who's lived in Bombay will have seen, on the pavements, very often in front of a post office, or sometimes even anywhere else, you know, you'll find an illiterate laborer dictating a letter to a scribe, you know. And the scribe writes the letter out for him for a fee.
That's right.
And this is the letter that the laborer sends home because he can't write. So, of course, I saw several of these, and it's always moved me, you know, to find this person from Andhra Pradesh who's come to Bombay and who's constructing these skyscrapers, you know. And he can't convey what he wants to say to his family and has to employ somebody else to do it. And the person who's doing it is literate and has the confidence of literacy.
Okay.
Whereas the person who's dictating the letter is unconfident, is hesitant, but he's the employer. It's a beautiful little drama, very human and also ironical. But I saw this, you know, and I kept this image with me for at least 5 or 6 years. Until one day I felt that, okay, today now I'm ready to address it.
Okay.
And that's when I start painting. And in fact, it's a test for me about how important that thing is for me. If something is not important for me, it will not stay with me.
Okay.
So it is not worth painting.
Okay.
If something stays with me for 5 years, then it's possibly worth painting.
So you're in no hurry to put it down?
Not at all.
Not at all. And if you could talk about a few more such series of works which have...
Well, another example again, you know,
yes.
You see amazing things on the streets in Bombay, you know. I once was passing by a little kind of pavement dwelling, you know, people who are street people, you know. They've just assembled a little house for themselves. Sitting outside there was a large, well-made man, but he had no arms.
Okay.
Both his arms had been amputated. And he was having a meal. So how was he having a meal? There's a little girl about 6 or 7 years old who was feeding him mouthful after mouthful. Mm. And it was just a stunning thing to see, you know.
Yeah.
And this was a well-built, you know, hefty man.
Mm.
And again, you know, this is an image I painted probably after 6 or 7 years, you know.
Okay, stayed with you.
Well, you know, by now you can already sort of have noticed that what interests me are street people, more or less, you know. I hardly ever paint interiors. I don't paint people in a drawing room or in a bedroom or inside a flat. Perhaps I have only one interior, which is the interior of a railway compartment. And that also looks more like an exterior because the landscape outside is coming in, you know.
Right.
So why this is so, again, I don't really have a very clear explanation, except that I'm drawn to the life on the streets, life outside the enclosed space.
Okay, okay. And so clothes and landscape and postures, everything becomes an integral part of the...
I mean, and particularly in a city like Bombay,
Bombay,
you know,
yes.
It's more or less lived outside.
True, true, absolutely. And so the drama on the streets has also turned for you into plays, because you have written three plays. So does, where did the need to write a play arise
the
from?
The plays are all about indoors.
Okay.
All three plays are about Parsis. I think many people in India know about Parsis, but possibly in the north fewer people do.
I agree.
That Parsis are a group of people who migrated from Persia about 1,000 years ago. They were Zoroastrians, and they were fleeing Islamic persecution, and they came in waves across the seas, across the Indian Ocean. And they landed in Gujarat, and they were allowed to settle in Gujarat and to practice their own religion.
Right.
And of course, you know, later on they became, you know, in a very interesting kind of way, integrated with the population of India. And they've contributed, you know, to industry and shipping and even politics. I think. Some prominent Parsi names most people know. So my three plays are about Parsis.
Okay.
And they are about Parsis in the village, which is, you know, the seaside villages of Gujarat.
Right.
Where they first immigrated.
Okay.
So there's that village life. And then there are the Parsis who then later on moved to Bombay and started industry and education and various other ventures.
Okay.
So some of my characters come from Bombay, some of my characters are from Gujarat. The village.
Okay, okay. And all the three plays are about Parsis.
They are about Parsis.
Mm. Even your poetry, I was reading.
An occasional poem.
And okay, yeah, especially one was very touching on communal riots.
That's
and
right, yes.
How Parsis never get to take any sides because they are not.
Right.
So that was very, very interesting. And what are you painting these days, or writing these days?
I'm likely to come out with a book of collected poems in about, say, a year or two.
Okay.
So that book will have all the three earlier books, plus some new works, new poems that I'm working on. There'll also be a small section of translations from 17th century Gujarati poetry into English.
Ah, yes, you've translated.
Yeah, this is a translation project that I've been working on for decades now.
Yes.
It's a Gujarati poet called Akho.
Yes.
And they're extremely interesting poems. They're, you know, they're mystical poems, but they are also very sharply observant of day-to-day life in Gujarat. And very sarcastic, very acerbic, you know. It there's a story that Akho himself moved from guru to guru. And he found each guru lacking. And finally, he achieved his enlightenment by his own effort, without the help of a guru.
Okay.
And this kind of somewhat, you might call, bitterness in finding imperfection, even in places where one would expect perfection, is present in the poetry, which makes it so very important, I think, for modern times.
Okay. So that is that continues, the translation?
So that project is continuing. Hmm. So I'll have some of these poems in the collected poems.
Okay, this would be a and you, but you haven't been writing, there was a large gap after the three anthologies of poetry?
There was a bit of a gap. Hmm. I think I was much more engaged in painting at the time.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
But I think I'm going to pick it up now.
Okay. So the abstract and the figurative also come together in your works, in your paintings.
I've been told so. it's not something that I intend, you know. Mm. But a lot of people have mentioned this, that even when I have a portrait head, for instance, they say that it has many abstract qualities to it. Maybe they're right. I think that possibly happens because when I'm painting, I'm working at two registers. On the one hand, I'm very conscious that I want that particular person on the canvas. But at the same time, I'm also extremely conscious of every brush stroke.
Okay.
And the way it relates to every other brush stroke. So this possibly is the abstract registration,
right?
You know, and the two somewhere or the other kind of like come together,
okay.
Which is when I feel satisfied with the work.
Gieve, there's also drawings and sculptures that you do. So if
yes.
you could talk a little about your sculptures and drawings, are they
different
from your subject matter in paintings? Or
The drawings, for instance, again, you know, they have this abstract quality. I've done different sets of drawings, but a very recent set, which has got a lot of attention, are these drawings of clouds.
Yes, I read about it.
Yeah. Mm. Again, you know, as a subject, if you're living in Bombay, you know, clouds is something that you are strongly aware of between the months of June and September. You know, our skies in Bombay, they are like a theater. You know, there's a procession, you know, continuous. It's a drama going on up there. And I'm fascinated by these clouds, you know, always have been. And again, so one day I said, can I, you know, this experience which means so much to me, can I portray it? So I had to decide how to do it. Am I going to do some painting? No. Can I do some drawing? Okay, but how? Hmm. Like, the logical thing about doing a cloud is to have ink, water, brush, and you make masses.
Right.
And I thought of that, and it felt just wrong. It felt, no, that's not the way I want to do it. So then I allowed my instinct to take over. And I started using pencils of different densities, or I started using Croquill and ink.
Croquill?
Croquill is a very specific and kind of nib.
Okay.
It's a very thin nib. And you require to develop a lot of skill to use it, because the ink often drops out of it onto the paper.
Oh, it's on a pen?
Yes.
Okay.
And it is very delicate.
Okay.
You know, it can give you very, very fine lines. But as you start using the nib more and more, it can also give you thicker lines.
Okay. Right?
But you know, you need a certain touch, and then you have to keep pushing it back into the inkwell and using it. Anyway, what happened was that I was using lines. I was not using a mass in a brush. So these clouds developed as lines. which in itself is a contradiction, you know, because the clouds are masses, you know, when you look at them. But here are these clouds developing like lines. And then these lines would mesh together, or they would fall apart from each other. And at a certain point, I would feel, ah, now it's complete. I don't touch it. Now, when I done a certain number of these drawings, I became aware of what was happening. As I said, you know, awareness always comes after the action. You don't think of how am I going to approach this subject and then do it. You do it instinctively, and then later on you say, ah, I did it because of A, B, and C.
Okay.
So, like, I became aware that what was fascinating me about the clouds is the fact that a cloud has no permanent form. Everything else that an artist takes and paints, whether it is a portrait head, an apple, a skull, you know, a landscape, it has a form, you know, it does not change.
True.
But the cloud is constantly changing, and it's changing in two ways. It is forming and it is dissolving at the same time. At one particular moment, it is doing both these things. So it is impossible to portray as a mass with a brush. The lines were the absolutely correct instinct, you know, because the lines can come together and they can flow apart.
Spoken like a poet.
So that's how these drawings develop.
It sounds like sheer poetry on canvas.
Paper.
Paper. And your sculptures?
The sculptures are a different story. You know, Shalini Shahani, the gallerist of Guild in Bombay, had been for a long time telling me, give me a sculpture show. And I said, I'd like to, but you know, the logistics, you know, I mean, how is one going to go to a foundry and cast things and mold things? And, you know, she said, I'll look after everything for you. You just go and work. But she was marvelous. She was so generous, you know. She took me to Jaipur to a foundry. She got me assistants. She got me a potter, you know. And I only had to conceive of things. And then I would ask the persons there, you know, like they supplied me with various kinds of clay.
I would say
I want to make an arm standing like that, you know. So how do I do it?
Ji.
So the potter made me a cylinder, just like that, you know. And then I worked on the surface of the cylinder, you know, with my fingers.
Okay.
And then I fixed a palm onto it. And so it was gorgeous because, like, in the first day, I produced 9 sculptures,
wow,
which for me is ridiculous because I'm such a slow worker.
Okay.
You know, when I went to Jaipur, I thought I'd come back after a month with 4 sculptures.
Yes.
In fact, in 3 weeks, I produced like something like about 20, 22 sculptures, you know.
Wow. And all in clay?
Clay, which then the foundry took over, and they made casts, and then it was set in bronze.
In bronze, okay. Yeah. And what was the sculptures about? What were the...
And the wonderful thing was, you know, that the moment I touched the clay, I felt so completely at home and familiar. The people, the workers there said, how long have you been working with clay?
Oh.
And I said, I started today. So they said, you know, you look like you've been working for 40 years with clay.
How interesting.
Yeah, okay, so it's just amazing. It's like as though there were a past life between me and that clay, you know.
So instinctive.
Yeah.
And do you continue working?
No, that was the one show, sculpture show I had.
Okay.
Not again.
But are you tempted to sometimes to?
Well, I'll need another galleries to come and tell me that they will host me.
So was it a different experience altogether as far as creating those works were concerned?
That it was very different, and you know, I'm very grateful for it. But you know, after that, I came back to my painting, you know, which is kind of really my base.
Okay.
And the subjects for these sculptures also, you know, it's interesting how it came about. Like all the time that Shalini was telling me, you know, you must do some sculptures for me, I was thinking, you know, what shall I do? What shall I work on? You know, various things were going on in my head. Then finally, when I went to Jaipur, it settled. And there were just two subjects. And they were both mythological. And I never otherwise touched mythology.
Okay.
That's also another departure, you know. So it seemed like this whole sculpture experience was a kind of a beautiful interlude of its own, you know.
Okay.
So my subjects were, number one, Ekalavya.
Okay.
Who everybody knows about.
Yes.
And the second subject was, so I had a number of sculptures of the palm without the thumb.
Okay.
You know. And the second subject was Daphne, which is from Greek mythology.
Mm.
And she's a river nymph.
Okay.
Who, in order to escape a rape by Apollo, prays to the forest gods. And just as Apollo catches her, she's transformed into a tree. So the sculptures are all showing the transformation of a female body or a female head into vegetation.
Okay.
Which is, you know, in a way, she's fortunate to have escaped the rape, but her fate is also tragic.
Mm. Absolutely. And tree also finds a lot of resonance in your poetry as well. Does it also appear in your paintings?
But the tree is again something that appears and reappears again.
Yes, yeah, yes. Yeah. So why? What is it? What?
Yeah. I think I've written somewhere that possibly trees are, having been on this earth for much longer than human beings,
yes,
have a greater right to be here than we do.
That's a beautiful poem, I remember it. Yes.
Yeah.
So that's the philosophy. And what about the new works? What are you working on these days? And how do these, do you wait and watch and mull over things before you start a new series, or?
I've been, always been interested in the human head.
Head?
Yes. And so, you know, like I've worked on the heads of my patients. I've taken photographs and I've reworked them. I've worked on heads again from memory. Lately, after a long gap, I've started reworking on a hard surface, a board, which is very different from a canvas. You know, when you put paint on a canvas, the canvas obligingly pushes back, you know, and absorbs some of that paint.
Right.
When you work on a board surface, the board pushes you back, you know. So it's a very different experience. And your touch has to be different accordingly.
Okay.
And also the board does not absorb the oil. So whatever you put on the board shouts back at you.
Mm.
So you have to work in a certain kind of way to create an image on the board, which I'm enjoying very much.
Okay.
And also these are heads again, which I'm finding. I pick up heads from newspaper photographs. And I isolate them, like, you know, they're not in the original context. So if there's somebody shouting in a photograph, and I have this head with a mouth open, but one doesn't know why that person is shouting or what is shouting about, which again, you know, puts it in a completely mysterious setting.
Okay. So this is the new series.
Yeah.
Okay. And what about other work? Any more plays coming?
There are no plays coming. And there will not be any more plays. I've written 3 plays, and they've been published in a handsome book by Seagull Publishers with wonderful photographs of the productions.
Okay. They've been staged.
That were staged, yeah. But I think that's the end of my theater career. I think that maybe I no longer have that kind of energy, you know, where I can work on painting and produce a play at the same time. Writing a play is very, very consuming.
Right.
And I think I need whatever I have for the painting.
For the painting, okay. And what else do you conceive doing in the future? Any more plans for painting, or it doesn't happen with you like that? No, there are no parameters.
I think it'll come as it comes.
Mm. Okay. And the new age work with different media that is being done these days in contemporary world, does it inspire you as well to use video or technique or film or because?
No, not really. I mean, I like some of the new works, but I'm rather cautious about it. I like it very selectively. I'm a bit fussy about it. But there are some videos which I've liked very much, and there are installations which I liked very much. I certainly will not, enter into that area, because it would be foolish to do that. You know, I mean, I belong to a different generation, and I think each generation explores different things.
Right. So you enjoy watching it, but as far as painting is concerned,
right.
You like to
That's right.
look at it yeah. a different way. And if you were to look back at life, so what is that? What did you enjoy most? Because you have practiced so many different things. Anything that you look back and say, yes, this is what was.
You know, at one point in my teens, when I was doing all these things, and I was confused, and I said, no, am I, you know, spreading myself out too much? Maybe I should concentrate on that. Maybe I should give up this. And people were always free with advice. And they would say, oh, you know, you're a very fine painter, but you're a rotten writer. So don't write, only paint. Somebody said, you know, medicine, you know, takes up all your time. You just give up everything else, and so on. And I used to go around in circles. Then one day, one blessed day, I told myself, I will do exactly as I want to do, which is I'll do everything.
Okay.
And I think that was a joyful decision.
Wonderful. So now you do only what you want to.
Absolutely.
And it's only painting these days, Gieve? That is
and writing.
Keeping you busy?
I've been
writing
doing
as well.
The poetry, yes.
Okay. And when is your next exhibition?
I think it should be I'm slow, as I said. It'll take a year or two.
Okay. And what this will be your heads?
The heads will be one part of the exhibition.
Okay.
There'll be drawings. But of a different nature, not like the
clouds.
Not clouds.
So clouds, the cloud series is over? Or do you
I might still explore them a bit, but for the moment, I think I'd like them to be quiet. but there's a set of drawings which I want to do, and I will not talk about them,
okay.
because they're very much in the formative stage.
Okay.
And they are very difficult, and they may not work.
Okay.
But I'm going to give them a try. If they work, I'll talk about them too some other time. And if they don't work, I'll tear them up.
So does it happen sometime, Gieve, that you think of something and when you start doing it, it doesn't work? Happened a lot of times?
Sure. No, but it doesn't happen a lot of time.
Okay.
Because since I take such a long time to think over something,
okay.
I think what you might call editing is already happening in my head.
Okay.
So that when I get down to doing it, I'm on fairly certain ground.
Okay.
But of course, you know, once in a while there'll be a drawing, set of drawings that don't work or a painting that doesn't work and, you know, then I just destroy it.
So, but mostly you have a clear picture in your mind what is going to happen.
I don't have a clear picture.
No.
I have a clear notion of moving in a certain direction.
Okay.
And then things take over.
And you look back at the canvas and you say, yes, this is what I...
Yes, then I look back at the canvas and then post-action, I give my stupid interpretations.
Gieve, you mentioned about your generation of painters. And so how about the generation of painters before you and now the new one? So what is the kind of relationship that you share, especially keeping in view the city of Mumbai? Considering that they form, is it a collaborative effort or are there certain undertones of competition or jealousies or is there a lot of free thought and free movement between all of you?
Yeah.
Especially subject matters like life in Bombay, life on the street, the common man, which also appear in different painters who paint from Mumbai. So how would you look back at these, your generation and the generation before you, the progressives? So yeah. what would be your ideas on that?
You know, there's a lot of oral history about artists in Bombay.
That's right.
I mean, when we meet together, we talk about, you know, what they have said on a certain occasion, or what, you know, Akbar said, you know. And Ranjit Hoskote, you know, is often part of our kind of group when we chat. And he always shakes his head, you know, very sort of looking very sorry. He says, you know, there's all this wonderful oral history, you know. I wish somebody would put it down on paper.
So true.
It's true, you know, because I've been fortunate to have been there at a time when artists of different generations responded to each other.
Okay.
You know, in various kinds of ways. I mean, I've already told you about how Akbar responded.
Absolutely.
And what was the result of it and the kind of friendship, you know, that we share today, you know. I mean, give you an example, like at around the same time before I met Akbar, I approached Tayyab as a young medical student, you know. And I said, after showing my work to Tayyab, and Tayyab was, you know, very dismissive of the work, hardly, barely polite. And when I said, well, okay, you know, it doesn't work, can you help me, you know? Can I come to you for classes regularly? He said, oh, classes? He says, you know, who am I to give classes? Which is exactly the kind of false modesty one would expect from Tayyab. But I mean, Tayyab is a dear man, you know.
Yes.
But I think all of us are amused and delighted by some of his attitudes. and that is what made Tayyab. You know, he had a certain kind of rigorousness. Like, he absolutely could not think of himself as a teacher, you know.
Okay.
He literally kind of physically recoiled from the idea. Whereas for Akbar, it is natural.
Okay.
Like, he kind of comes forward at you as a teacher.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But these are the amazing relationship variations that you get, you know.
Hmm.
Akbar, for instance, has been able to relate to two generations after him. With me, with Sudhir Patwardhan, with Atul and Anju Dodia, you know, and all of them will tell you how much they have learned from him.
Okay.
And all of them, including myself, will also tell you how much we have learned from Tayyab, but not because he came forward to give it to us, but because we took it from him, you know,
okay.
From
okay.
his work and from the, you know, occasional talk that we had with him.
Okay, okay. And,
I'm told today that some of the younger people find it difficult to meet together and talk about each other's works. I'm not, you know, fabricating a story. Some of the younger artists themselves have come and told me this. And I think that is tragic, you know. It's a great loss when artists can't talk to each other.
True.
Because you don't produce your work in isolation, you know?
Yes.
Your work is the result, not just of yourself in a closed room, you know? It's because of the people who have worked before you, the people who have worked alongside you. And I feel absolutely blessed that I've had people like Akbar and Tayyab. I have people like Sudhir and Atul and Anju, you know. We are constantly meeting.
Okay.
And we talk about each other's work.
Okay.
You know. We are careful. To talk to an artist about his own work is not an easy thing. You know. You can't just blurt out things, you know, you can't be insensitive. Even if you don't like a work, there is a very special way of having to convey that.
True.
You know? And after a while, we become expert at that.
But do you think it's the market forces that hinder this process of interaction between younger artists? Or is this...
I can't say. I mean, I don't know them well enough, you know, and I not, don't know many of them well enough. But the fact that they have said, yes, we don't. And I've even heard of, you know, people saying, oh, so-and-so will come to my studio and steal my ideas. I can't imagine anybody of an earlier generation or of my generation even having distantly, even the thought occurring to them.
Absolutely.
Of such a thing, you know. So I don't understand it.
Mm. And do you like to share your thoughts, etc., with the younger generation?
Anybody.
Okay.
Anybody. So, I mean, I'd love to meet them, you know, but I don't think they want to meet me.
And did teaching ever cross your mind when you talk about...
Painting I have not taught. Mm. Poetry I teach.
Okay.
I go to Rishi Valley School regularly.
Okay.
I've been going for the last 20 years.
Wow.
Once a year for 3 weeks in January, and I take a poetry workshop there with them, with the kids. Okay. The school invites me year after year. They seem to like what I'm doing.
Okay.
And we look at some of the greatest poets from all over the world.
Okay. As part of the workshop?
Yes, with in English translations, okay. Including poets from India. And after studying these poems, I want the students to write their own poetry,
okay,
which they do, and we even brought out an anthology of their poems, which the Sahitya Academy has published.
Oh, how wonderful!
With wonderful illustrations by Nilima Sheikh, Anju Dodia, Atul Dodia, and Sudhir Patwardhan.
Really? And what is the title?
The title is Poetry with Young People.
How interesting!
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
I think it's a collector's item, that book.
Wonderful.
I mean, you know, very much because of the illustrations.
Absolutely.
But also because of the quality of the poetry written by the students.
Okay. Gieve, you're a writer yourself. So, 20 years back, the newspapers had a permanent critics column on art, and exhibitions would be reviewed, and there'd be a lot of writing on art, and also on poetry and theatre as well. So, when you look back and you look now, do you feel there is a certain kind of lack of that which also influences artists, or has it personally anything that you feel strongly about as far as writing on art is concerned in your time or your generation? And how is it now? For instance, there's hardly any happening in newspapers, but what about the new few writers who write on art?
I think, you know, as you'd expect, things change. Hmm. And I think that there's been a massive change in the whole notion of writing on art. And I think we have to accept, just as we accept change in art itself,
right,
you know, we have to accept change in writing on art. You know? For one thing, some of the writers of the 60s who used to write in the papers, like Nissim Ezekiel, for instance, their critique of an exhibition would be really what one would call a critique.
That's right.
Rather than an expounding, you know, which means that they would make no bones about saying that this exhibition doesn't work for reasons A, B, C, and D, you know. Or that in this particular exhibition, this particular painting is a disaster, but that one, you know, seems to be going somewhere. Now, this kind of writing is almost completely gone now today, for whatever reason, I don't know. I'm not saying that that it should be around. Maybe it should, you know. Maybe at least some part of art writing should be like that, you know, where there is very clear judgment.
Okay.
Because I think that it does pep up, you know, it makes people sit up to say, something can be awful and yet can be put up on a gallery wall.
Right.
So, you know, it should not be there. Now, look at the distance between this and Danto's statement today about what is art, where he says, that which is on the walls of the gallery is art. You know, what he's saying is that anything that is accepted by quote unquote the art world is by definition art. Whereas the earlier critic was saying that the art world may accept whatever it wants to accept, but I don't accept it.
Right.
This distinction is interesting and you know, needs to be thought about.
Okay.
Now, having said this, I must tell you that, you know, some of the writers who write on art in Bombay today are very good close friends.
Okay.
You know, the people like Ranjit Hoskote, like Nancy Adajania. Girish Sahane, I don't meet as often, but when I do, I enjoy very much talking to him about art, you know. I would say that, you know, they are searching, just as artists are searching. They are looking out for how they should write about art. And of course, in the process, they are producing wonderful essays.
Essays, yes.
Which all of us read and enjoy. But it is what you might call the new writing, you know. And I'm not always in step with it.
Right.
And this is a generation thing, you know, one has to admit it. But I'm very grateful for their presence because I think that an art scene without a contingent of writers on art is barren.
Okay.
One of the earliest pieces I edited in the 70s for the journal Debonair had a group title called Paintings Must Be Talked About.
Okay.
And under that title, I invited several people, Geeta Kapoor, Sudhir Patwardhan, Adil Jasawala, Mala Marwa, to write individual essays on particular artists or art events which excited them.
Okay.
You know. So I was aware all the way back in the 70s, to in order to use a covering title like Painting Must Be Talked About, I was aware of the importance of
talking,
of responses.
Okay.
And responses made public by writing.
But is it limited only to English, or is it there is a lot of regional writing?
There's a lot of regional writing, and I believe more and more of it is being researched today. And I think they are more likely to uncover a whole lot of riches from regional writings on art in the next 10 years.
Okay.
It's all archival material, which is being brought out slowly.
Also translations happening.
Well, I'm sure they'll come up.
They'll come up.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Thank you, Gieve.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.